pray that you're well on today. This is Pastor Hagwood, pastor of First Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church in Charlotte, North Carolina, where we are exalting Christ to restore, renew, and rebuild people to serve the kingdom of God. God's blessings to you on today. Again, this is April 11, 2021, the second Sunday in the month of April. And for our First Mount Zion members, you see where I am. I'm actually in our sanctuary. Felt led today not to just do our Sunday school and virtual worship, but really just more so do one succinct lesson in our Sunday school, and then to kind of talk through that lesson and also what it's maybe telling us about how we're being led by the Spirit of God during these crazy times. Okay, we're in some very weird times, of course, because of pandemic and things of that nature. And I want everyone to kind of get, kind of take a step back for a minute. I'm not going to necessarily preach per se, but I'm more so teach on today, because there's just been a lot of things resonant in my mind and in my spirit. And I had no intention today of coming to First Mount Zion, to come into our campus, but the Lord led me this way. And I literally got up and I said, I'm not going to go through the process. God was like, no, you're not going to go through that process of what you normally do during virtual Sunday school and virtual worship. I want you to go over to the campus. And that's what I did. And so I grabbed all of my materials, came here, meditated, prayed. I took some pictures, which I posted actually on our Facebook page. And just to let members know what's been going on, some of the things that are going on, we have three new screens actually that we have up in our sanctuary, which if you look on our Facebook page, you will see the pictures of those. And that's where I am right now. Some things are a little in disarray. You might see tables turned and chairs turned and so forth in various directions. It's because of a lot of work, of the work that's being done within our sanctuary. So other work is also being done on our campus that you just can't see. Work on our steeple that's been done, as well as other things in the fellowship hall, floors being waxed and stripped, and things of that nature. And then other work that we're looking at, you know, getting done within the church, even in the pandemic, and even at the emphasis of what I, you know, preached on last week, that the tomb, if the tomb is still open, we're open, because the church is never closed. And so I wanted to make sure, from a First Mount Zion perspective, and anyone that's watching us even now, that understand that the church is alive and well, even in the midst of chaotic times and even confusing times, that the aspect of, or the reality of, the church, the ecclesia, if you will, truly that Jesus told Peter, upon this rock I'll build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. That's the reality. And so we must realize that, again, if the church is dead, that means Christ has to be dead. And we know that Christ isn't dead. We know Christ is alive and well. And Christ is alive, which we know he's alive. We have been verified by the empty tomb that he's alive. That means the church is open and the church is alive. So with that being said, I want to get into our lesson today from our Sunday school. And that's really where I'm going to really put our focus. I've got a few comments at the very end that I'll give and so forth, especially for Mount Zion members. I will ask you to please read the announcements that are posted on the social media page. I was having problems with the calling post, which I've already talked with Sister Doretha Adams, been texting, actually going back and forth with her. The passwords have been reset, and I got to go back and reload that on my cell phone, so I can be able to do the all calls from wherever I am. If I have the app, then I can do it, the all calls from wherever I am, and actually set the time schedule so I can get the communications out to the church as needed. Please be in prayer for Minister Robbie Clark and her family in the passing of her brother, Reverend Willie Simpson. The funeral services have been announced. I did post that as well on our social media page, so you should be able to see the obituary as well as the times I think it's going to be on Friday, if I'm not mistaken, this coming Friday, from 11, I think 11 to 12 is viewing, 12 o'clock, or is it, I'm not going to, let me not speak about the times because I'm going to get it wrong, but definitely it's posted on our Facebook page. Please, ma'am, please, sir, communicate that to as many people as possible and make sure you share that. We'll get that hopefully on the calling post once we can get the IDs and passwords straight on our calling post, and then we'll get that communicated to the entire church. But right now, I've only posted it on social media. Also, the announcements for the week are also on the social media page for First Mount Zion. I posted those. Sister Ware was gracious enough to get those to me, and I made sure I posted those. You will hear those on the next calling post as well, because again, I've got to access and be able to get access again to the calling post so I can actually make those specific announcements. So with that being said, again, thank God for all of you, First Mount Zion family and the virtual family that's worshiping with us on today. Again, we just thank God for all that he continues to do and what he's doing in the midst of where we are even right now. So with that being said, we're going to go into our lesson today, which is Ezra, Faith and Action Preacher. Ezra, Faith and Action Preacher, which comes from the Old Testament book of Ezra, chapter 10, verses 1 through 12. And Ezra is a very interesting book, and I want to give a little lesson in regards to that book, just to give you some background information. Ezra, where it's located in Scripture, okay, where it's located in Scripture, you must not read it chronologically as far as you're reading the books of the Bible. So if you get through all of the five Pentateuch books, meaning Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, and then you start getting other books, then all of a sudden you run into Ezra and then Nehemiah. Well, that actually is really kind of housed really after the 70-year exile, okay? After the 70-year exile of Israel by the Babylonians out of Israel into Babylonian captivity. Ezra and Nehemiah really capture the kind of rebuilding, if you will, spiritually, of the nation of Israel coming back into the land of Israel after Persia conquered Babylon and Nebuchadnezzar. What ended up happening was that they allowed space for the Israelites to actually begin actually their practice of worship of Yahweh. So what ended up happening was that they ended up eventually going back to Israel, but it started with a lot of rebuilding of Israel and the temple and the wall of Jerusalem because of the conquered or the beaten down city of Jerusalem after the Chaldeans, Nebuchadnezzar, and Babylon had came in and actually destroyed Jerusalem. So there's a rebuilding that's going on in that regard. And I told many at First Mount Zion, that's kind of how I've viewed and view my pastoral responsibilities here at First Mount Zion. I look at it as a rebuilding. Matter of fact, I believe part of our vision statement and even what you all gave to me, you know, years ago in regards to casting the vision for the church, again, is exalting Christ to restore, renew, and rebuild people. So I look at our church as a place of rebuild. Okay, not only internally, but also for those coming in, you know, the immediate community that we're in, you know, the immediate, the immediate community of West Corridor, West Boulevard, Wilkinson, and Remount Road, where we're on, you know, to be able to come and to connect with our community. You know, our community is changing. It is. You know, there's a lot of gentrification going on in Charlotte, and we're starting to see it on the west side now. But still, there's a huge need in our community for the efficacy, if you will, of the gospel, to be able to preach it and teach it in a way that allows us to reach out to anyone who wants to experience the salvation of Jesus Christ in the land of the living. And because of that, that begins our process, I think, within our church. Even with the pictures that I put up on our Facebook page, of you see the new screens and things of that nature. This lesson, God is right on time, because when I went through this lesson, much of what we've experienced and still are experiencing is really a rebuilding and really a Ezra, Nehemiah experience that we're having. And I believe that it's going to be for our better and for our good, not only, you know, during the pandemic, but post the pandemic. I believe God is beginning to set some things up for his church, and specifically for this branch of Zion called First Mount Zion. And I think God is going to continue to make ways and make efforts for us to promote the gospel and to promote the life of Jesus Christ, life of ministry of Jesus Christ, through what we do in this space. So with that being said, I believe that's one of the motivations that brought me here on today. Again, I just felt a tug and prod this morning, and I said, I'm going over to the church, and I'm going to actually have, you know, the study from the church and from the pulpit, and that's where I am right now on today. So I brought all my stuff and came over, and I'm right here, and we're right here, you know, doing what we do in order to promote, again, the life of Jesus Christ, and knowing that truly he saves still now, as he even saved yesterday, and he'll continue to save people even beyond this place. So with that being said, I want to get into our lesson today, and I hope that it connects with all of us on some level with regards to our walk with God and journey with God. It says here, our aim for change, it says, by the end of this lesson, we will contrast the people's need for repentance with their joyful response to God's word. Believe that God's truth is eternal, and grow in determination to serve God in our community and beyond. And our end focus reads this way. It says, the official board of First Church called a congregational meeting to discuss the church's constitution. The constitution was written 150 years ago and did not reflect the changing racial structure of the community that the church served. Deacon Robinson, the moderator, called the meeting to order. He explained to the congregation that the church's constitution had to be reformed if First Church was to survive. Some of the older members were concerned that changing the constitution would mean changing the purpose and character of First Church. However, what was really at stake was the way the church would do ministry in the 21st century. At one point, old Mr. Johnson stood to speak. I'm the longest attending member of this church. I have been here through three pastors. Change can be a scary word for some people. We are creatures of habit, so it is difficult for some of us to accept changes, whether in our worship style or our personal lives. Certainly, one of the most frightening times in our lives is when we move to a new apartment or take on a new job. But I have stayed here through many changes, and I can tell you they have, for the most part, been good ones. This church has a good heart, and we want to follow God. His rules aren't going to change, so maybe ours should. And after 3 hours of intense discussion and mixed emotions, the congregation gave the board the okay to proceed with rewriting the Constitution. And the question here says, this week we will study God's call through Ezra for the nation of Israel, for the nation of Israel to change their lives through religious and moral reform. What are some ways God is guiding you to better walk in obedience to his will? And you have to answer that question for yourself, but I'll be honest with you. When we think about the pandemic, so many things have been on pause lately, that it has allowed, at least for me personally, it has allowed me to really do some serious introspection, to really look at myself personally, and to really look at what things are going right, what things aren't so great. You know, God, where do I need improvement? And help me in those areas, not only to help me, but to help me in leading my family, in leading First Mount Zion Church, to go through the process of being able to be the best individual that God has purposed me to be. But sometimes it takes pause in order to do that. And so even in chaotic times, where times are sometimes confusing for whatever reason, maybe if certain events have happened, cataclysmic events that have given swift change, if you will, or have brought us to a place where we have no choice But to be still and to pause, it gives us our essence to be able to now sit back and come through a process with God, to be able to sit down and hear God's voice, to be still, okay? Because in our 21st century, we move with so much expectancy and with expedience, trying to get to the next thing without pausing long enough to hear God's voice, to be able to pray to God long enough to hear God's voice. And it's amazing, I think, when we really think about it, that, you know, what we're going to embark upon this lesson, the guiding forces that, you know, move us to a better walk in obedience to God's will first require us to be still. Psalms 46 and 10 says it, of course, best: be still and know that I'm God. Because sometimes it's the matter of the stillness where you have to be able to hear God in order to be led and in order to lead God's people. And I'm learning more and more, just shut up. Just be quiet and let God minister to you. I want you to think about that, because if we would sometimes just be quiet, not say anything, pull back, if you will, get in a quiet space. And I believe that's one of the reasons why God brought me to the church today, brought me to the sanctuary, because I knew it would be no one here, and also it would be still, and I could hear God's voice. And I think that's something that we have to think about if we're thinking about moving to the next plateau or the next level that God has for us. That we must come to some level of understanding that you've got to be able to hear God's voice as we proceed through the fixtures and chaos and confusion, whatever else that we're going through. What is God saying to us to move to the next plateau? In this lesson, what you're going to see is the folks of Israel, they're coming out of exile. Okay, they're out of that Babylonian captivity. They're coming back to Israel. And the largest issue that they have is they have limited identity of who they are. Now, I'll deal with this a little bit now, but I'll get to it in the lesson. Identity, you knowing or us knowing who we are in Christ, is pivotal for us before we take any next steps going forward. That is pivotal for us, because when you're walking without guidance, you're being misled. Did I say something there? Let me say that again. When you are walking without being guided, you're being misled. So it takes for us being able to pause to see where God is working in, on, and through us before the next steps are taken, and that we're doing it by way of the purpose of God. And I may sound very simplistic and basic and rudimentary when I say all this, but I believe this is an elementary procedure that we have to come to in our own dynamics of spiritual life. How we speak to God and how God speaks to us in the level of devotion. How much devotion time are we spending with God to allow God to speak to us, to show us direction, to show us which way we need to go? Again, this is pivotal. Because when we start to really think about our lives, if we're just going and going and going, the question then should soon become, where are we going? Where are we being led to? Or are we even being led at all? And we're just going without hearing God's voice as to where it is that we need to go. Okay? Keep this in mind. Okay? I want to dig with this. Dig in this a little bit when we get into further into this lesson. But again, you know, some of the ways of God, that God is guiding you to better walk in obedience with Him. For me, again, a place of being still. And as busy as your pastor is in regards to church, you see me running all the time. This is where I often get caught up, is that I oftentimes don't take enough time to pause to hear God's voice. And that's something that I'm trying to reverse going forward, because I really need to hear God's voice and meditate more on God's word and meditate with God in prayer for direction of where to be led. Okay? So with that, our keep in mind scripture in our lesson is Ezra chapter 10, verses 10 and 11. And it says this: "Then Ezra the priest stood and said to them, 'You have committed a terrible sin. You have increased Israel's guilt. So now confess your sin to the Lord, the God of your ancestors, and do what he demands. Separate yourselves from the people of the land.'" Again, that's Ezra 10, verses 10 through 11 from the New Living Translation of God's Word. Let's go a little further here into kind of the background, but also, some of the aspects of not only the background, but the places and so forth that are in our scripture. And also a question before we even get into our text on this morning. Let me read this. It says, "For decades, God sent many prophets to warn Israel and Judah that their disobedience and lack of repentance would ultimately lead to their destruction. These prophecies were fulfilled when Assyria conquered Israel in 722 BC, followed by Judah's fall in 586 BC at the hands of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. It was then that the temple was destroyed. However, the people did not leave them without hope. Promising the return of a remnant of the people and rebuilding of the temple," as Jeremiah 27 and 22, "this fulfillment began in 538 BC when Zerubbabel led the first group to Jerusalem to start rebuilding the temple." That's in Ezra chapter 1 through 6. "The priest, Ezra, led a second group's return. Both returns were authorized and aided by unlikely sources. The kings of Persia, who had conquered Babylon. In this passage, we see Ezra addressing the people who appear to be heading down a similar sinful path as their forefathers. His focus becomes to lead the people to not only a physical return, but a spiritual return of their hearts toward the one true God." And the question that's asked here is, where do you see God at work in your life, calling you back to him and rebuilding your faith? Let me repeat the question again. Where do you see God at work in your life and calling you back to him and rebuilding your faith? I'm going to take it right now from the pandemic perspective, right now that we're in. It is amazing how our church, First Mount Zion, has really come together over the course of this year and some months, okay? Year and a month, I guess, from last year when the pandemic began. And what I've seen is that we've had leadership changes that we've made administratively here in the church, which I believe is going to be for the betterment of the church once we get back into the building itself. But for the church right now, I believe is one of the best things that has happened for First Mount Zion, because we're beginning to see change. We're beginning to see newness. We're beginning to see a refresh and of the Holy Spirit, like rushing water, like rushing wind, blowing the pollen away, blowing, you know, the leaves out, blowing the mess out, taking rushing water and cleansing us and beginning the process of his spirit to bring us into a newness that I believe is going to be better for us in the near future and going beyond. And I honestly believe that because of the changes that are going back, that God is calling us back to an authentic and genuine relationship with Him that has nothing to do with superfluous stuff, with superficial stuff. And I know you're saying, oh, Pastor, there you go with those big words again. So let me just break it down. Break it down for you. He doesn't want to see phoniness. He doesn't want to see fakeness. He doesn't want to see aspects of us being pulling facades, falsehoods, and acting like the church, but not being the church. He doesn't want to see any of that. And I believe in the pandemic, He has allowed us to be still long enough and to be to some degree shut up long enough in order to hear His voice and say there has to be something new. And in order for you to see it, and in order for you to hear what it is that I'm trying to get you to do and a purpose you to do, that I need you to be still so you can hear my voice. Because now we don't have the busyness of church right now. We don't have the busyness of people just going through the pews and going through the building and going through room to room and the fellowship hall and everywhere. We don't have that right now. So there's a place of pause that we're in. And because we're in that place of pause, this is where God is giving us space to hear what He has to say, but also to go to God honestly with a level of genuineness and say, God, what's wrong with me? What, help me right now in the place where I am. Purge me like hyssop. Cleanse me and wash me clean. And I believe that when we begin the process of coming to God in a real way, in an authentic manner, in a manner that has no facades tied to it, that God will speak to us. And I believe He's speaking to us now. So I believe there's an ushering of the Spirit that we're starting to see. And I believe that with some of the changes that we have begun to institute, even within our own church, that we're now seeing, again, screens come up, okay? Remember, these are resources. These are blessings that God has given us. But we can't be blessed by God until we're able to repent and come to some resolution with God as to where we need improvement. Everybody wants to be blessed, but no one wants to go through a process. Can I say that again? Everyone wants to be blessed, but no one wants to go through a process in order to be blessed. And the process, a lot of times, hurts more, of course, than the blessing that's received. So God is trying not to hurt us, but to show us where we may have dysfunction, where we may have chaos, where we may have confusion. In the Hebrew, it's called tohu. And when God shows us that and we're ready to repent to God and place that at the altar, then God can deal with us and guide us into paths of righteousness for His name's sake. And this is why it's important that when you're in any type of system, if you will, and specifically the church, that we're able to open our eyes to what's really going on, or at least at minimum, ask God wholeheartedly, Lord, examine me. Show me what it is that where I'm wrong. Show me where I need improvement. And when we begin to improve, based off what the Spirit begins to blow out, begins to wash out by way of the Spirit of God, it will give us clarity of mind and of heart to do the assignments which God has called us to do, and to do them with the Spirit that is centered in Jesus Christ. That's why this is important. And you see, the way I'm teaching you is definitely different than most Sunday school lessons, because I'm trying to mix both a little bit of preaching and teaching together, because the reality becomes for the church that in order for us to progress forward, we must look at ourselves and examine ourselves. What has your pastor said more and more times over during communion? That a man should examine himself before coming to the Lord's table. A man should examine himself before pursuing and moving to the next step of doing something to ensure that it's tied to the purposes of God and that we're listening to God's voice as we move. Very important. Otherwise, church becomes busy work. And this should never be busy work. This should be about kingdom work that has purpose and has vision for the larger community as well as our internal community. That's why it's important. And this is how, when we do that, it rebuilds our faith to be retooled to do more of the work that Christ is wanting us to do in his church. I hope you get that. And I teach this in love, because when we begin to do that, what we will find is that when we come back into the space that we're in, we come back into the space, it's going to look different. Don't be in so much of a rush to get into this space without having your spirit transformed. That's what I'm saying. Don't rush. I want to get to the church. But you're not realizing that you're the church. The church isn't this building. Church is you. Church is you. And when we all come together in one like mind, watch the wonders that God will do. It will baffle us. It will wow us. It might knock us slain in the spirit on the floor. What God will do through us, if only we see ourselves in correct eyesight and vision, that the building is not the church. Getting into the building doesn't change anything. The change comes from within us. This just houses it. That's all. This is where we gather together in one like mind. That's why we have to be in one like mind before we get back. So the question becomes, what are you doing to rebuild the aspect of your faith right now before you come back into the space? Just like the children of Israel, again, they came out of exile. But it's one thing to get to Jerusalem and everything is still haywire and chaotic. You have to get your spirit right before you get back into God's house. Because remember, we're the church. You're the church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Let me move into our lesson. I'm going to read the scriptures here, Ezra chapter 10, verses 1 through 12. And I'm going to read these straightforward, and we'll get into some dialogue and so forth. It says, while Ezra prayed and made this confession, weeping and lying face down on the ground in front of the temple of God, a very large crowd of people from Israel, men, women, and children, gathered and wept bitterly with him. Then Shekaniah, son of Jehiel, a descendant of Elam, said to Ezra, we have been unfaithful to our God, for we have married these pagan women of the land. But in spite of this, there is hope for Israel. Let us now make a covenant with our God to divorce our pagan wives and to send them away with their children. We will follow the advice given by you and by the others who respect the commands of our God. Let it be done according to the law of God. Get up, for it is your duty to tell us how to proceed in setting things straight. We are behind you, so be strong and take action. So Ezra stood up and demanded that the leaders of the priests and the Levites and all the people of Israel swear that they would do as Shekaniah had said, and they all swore a solemn oath. Then Ezra left the front of the temple of God and went to the room of Jehohanan, son of Elisahib. He spent the night there without eating or drinking anything. He was still in mourning because of the unfaithfulness of the returned exiles. Then a proclamation was made throughout Judah and Jerusalem that all the exiles should come to Jerusalem. Those who failed to come within 3 days would, if the leaders and elders so decided, forfeit all their property and be expelled from the assembly of the exiles. Within 3 days, all the people of Judah and Benjamin had gathered in Jerusalem. This took place on December 19th, and all people were sitting in the square before the temple of God. They were trembling both because of the seriousness of the matter and because it was raining. Then Ezra the priest stood and said to them, you have committed a terrible sin by marrying pagan women. You have increased Israel's guilt. So now confess your sin to the Lord, the God of your ancestors, and do what he demands. Separate yourselves from the people of the land and from these pagan women. Then the whole assembly raised their voices and answered, yes, you are right. We must do as you say. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his holy word. Now, what we have here is where Ezra, again, there is this aspect that Ezra prays. Let me read verses 1 through 4. That's where we have the center. He says, while Ezra prayed and made his confession, weeping and lying face down on the ground in front of the temple of God, a very large crowd of people from Israel, men, women, and children, gathered and wept bitterly with him. Then Shechaniah, son of Jehiel, descendant of Elam, said to Ezra, we have been unfaithful to our God, for we have married these pagan women of the land, but in spite of this, there is hope for Israel. Let us now make a covenant with our God to divorce our pagan wives and to send them away with their children, and we will follow the advice given by you and by the others who respect the commands of our God. Let it be done according to the law of God. Get up, for it is your duty to tell us how to proceed in getting things straight. We are behind you, so be strong and take action. So what we have here is Shechaniah, who was part of the exile group coming back, is now speaking to Ezra directly. Now, Ezra has been praying, okay? Ezra's been praying and making confession, weeping and lying face down. He's been making petitions for the people. Now, Shechaniah, who is part, of course, of Israel and of the people, he comes to basically to Ezra and says, we messed up. We got it wrong. We completely flipped this, and we need to get things straight with God. We need to get our lives back in order with God, because we've been away from God for so long that now it's time for us to come to a place where we can get together and get back in covenant with God, because we have been out of covenant with God for so long. And I believe one of the things that we learn from this is that, one, you have a priest, preacher, if you will, in Ezra, who is praying for the people of Israel to come back to God. Okay? We're not talking about the people who don't know God. They knew who God was. But the point is that they got to a place and point where the exile had taken them away from God. Now think about this. We have been in exile from this building for over a year. We've been in exile from the place that we call the church for over a year. And so in this time, the question becomes, what has been circumvented within our spirit to come to a place of looking at ourselves and examining ourselves, because people have been praying. This pastor has been praying for the members of First Mount Zion, even in the midst of this pandemic, that we as a community will continue to be hosed, that we will continue to be united, that we will continue to do the work of God, and that we won't slip, because at the end of the day, we have to stay in right bounds and right due with God. But for some reason, and it's not just here at First Mount Zion, it's other churches as well. If you're a member of another church, then you take it to the aspect of where you are. But the reality becomes is that we've been separated from the place that we've called the church, then we feel that there's no reason to be the church, even though God said you are the church once you chose me. And that's why it's important for us to make sure that even when we're separated from a place that we are hold up, that we've held on to, and that we are used to coming to and used to being in fellowship, that if that is taken away, does that mean that the church is dead? Does that mean that the church is closed? Does that mean that the people of God are separated from God's relationship? No, that means that maybe we need to take a step back to take the fortitude and the power upon which God has placed inside of us by way of his Holy Spirit, because if something has been taken away from us, that becomes the source if we put our source of power into it. This place has no power in and of itself. It doesn't have any power in and of itself. The power is in you. If we're the church, remember what Jesus told Peter, upon this rock I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. There is no demon or no devil in hell that can keep us away from being God's church. That's the reality. And as long as we remember that, then we can come to some level of reckoning with God, that God says that when we become separated from him, not this building, but from him, that we can come back in right relationship and covenant with him. That's why right now in the places of those darkest valleys and those deep depths that we may find ourselves in because of the pandemic, you better reach for God even more now than you did when we're in this church and in this building, because that's the power which holds us together. And because of that, Ezra understood. He said, I'm going to pray for the people. I'm going to weep on their behalf. I'm going to lay prostrate before God. And God, I love you and I love the people. And I'm praying and interceding on behalf of them. Because when they come out of this exile back into Jerusalem, it's not going to look like it looked when they left, because everything's been destroyed. But can they see the reality and essence and fortitude of the power within what you've already given them, and that power resides in them, and that no weapon formed against them will prosper? This is why it's so important when adversity comes, when pandemics come, that we're not so locked in to a building. What does the 10th commandment say in the Decalogue, the 10 commandments? Exodus chapter 20, if you want to go there. And also I think Deuteronomy chapter 4 or either 5. The last commandment is do not covet. Do not covet. Do not want this building so bad to the point where it decreases your relationship with God. Your relationship with God should be that much more strengthened, because it's not the building, it's you and your relationship with Christ, with God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. So be empowered, be motivated, be encouraged, because as you are increasing in faith, when this building does open back up, that's what you're bringing with you. A new mindset, a new way of doing things, a new thing. Something to think about. Let me read this for you from the commentator writer. He says in chapter 9, several leaders brought to Ezra's attention that some of the men had married pagan women and produced with them. And that was the sin that they were dealing with. Ezra's response was one of lament. God had faithfully delivered them from the 70 years in exile as promised. And here they were seemingly determined to return to the evil that led to their destruction. Let me stop right there. This is why you can't put new wine in old wineskins. as Jesus explained. You can't do it because the old wineskin will burst. Because you're trying to put something new into something old. Meaning that you can't bring an old spirit back into the building that you call the church building. It must be fresh and it must be new. Because if you're trying to bring something old, it's only going to lead us to destruction. That's why things are being done new within our church. The pandemic, and I kind of hate to say it this way, but more so the pause of the pandemic was a blessing. The pause that the pandemic created was a blessing for the church. Not only First Mount Zion, but for many churches across the world. This pause has given us time to look at ourselves and also to hear from God, because he's been examining us and telling us there's some things that need to change if you wish to be in right relationship and purpose to what I am trying to do through you for my kingdom. That's why it's so important. And when we read this, I'm going to keep reading the commentator writer. It says, as was ancient Jewish custom, Ezra tore his clothes and plucked the hair from his head and beard and fasted, prayed and confessed and wept loudly as a public expression of grief and astonishment. Again, that weeping, fasting, sackcloth, ashes, dust on the head, that was all signs of, God, we messed up. Forgive us. Forgive us for our sins and our transgressions, and lead us back to paths of righteousness for your name's sake. That's all that was. And so when you have that, God hears that. But I'll be honest with you, some of us will not pray for forgiveness because we feel we've done nothing wrong. Remember what Paul said in Romans 3:23, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So because of that, that should tell us that we're not perfect. That's the first thing. Two, because of our imperfection, that we are dependent upon God in order for him to forgive us on a regular basis. We must always find ourselves in meditation and devotion to God, because we always want to be in right relationship with God, to be guided appropriately by his Spirit. Let me read a little further. Such a public outcry compelled others to join him. Shechaniah was moved to publicly confess on behalf of the community a sin that he did not commit. His name is not on the list. I guess it's verses 18 through 43 in that same chapter. Chapter 10. It is possible, however, that his disdain and grief were still personal, as he may have been related to one of the offenders. He is identified as the son of Jehiel, one of the sons of Elam, and there is a Jehiel listed among the sons of Elam who defied God's law. Sheshaniah's response was filled with hope, support, and admonishment. As he proposed a covenant with the Lord, the utmost binding form of commitment, his solution to send away those wives who still worship pagan gods along with their children was a difficult one to execute, but revealed his commitment to holiness and the law of God. They wanted to get it right with God. And when we want to get it right with God, God will lead us into paths of righteousness, of his righteousness, in order that we can see his purpose, hear his purpose, and begin to execute it, even within our own personal lives. Even before we get into the place of the gathering that we call the church, okay? That personally, where am I in my relationship with God? And that should identify how we're relating to each other, okay? There should not be disdain and grief and haughtiness and hatefulness, if you will, when it comes to relationships, and especially relationships amongst God's people. In order to start getting down that path, we have to begin and or allow God to begin or continue the work of cleansing our hearts. What did David say? Create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. Let's go a little further. Verses 5 and 6. So Ezra stood up and demanded that the leaders of the priests and Levites and all the people of Israel swear that they would do as Shechaniah had said. And they all swore a solemn oath. Then Ezra left the front of the temple of God and went to the room of Jehoiada, son of Eliashib. He spent the night there without eating or drinking anything. He was still in mourning because of the unfaithfulness of the returned exiles. Listen to this. Shechaniah's admonition, be of good courage and do it, was reminiscent of God's command to Joshua as he prepared to lead Israel into the promised land after 40 years of wandering. Due to their father's lack of faith, as in Joshua 1 and 6, generations later, Ezra was now tasked with spiritually leading a remnant of exiled Jews back to the Lord. His call of repentance meant all of Israel would have to swear to keep their promise under the threat of severe punishment. Twice it is mentioned that he arose, indicating Ezra continued to bow before the Lord in mourning. Even after Israel swore an oath, he did not celebrate. He returned to the room of the high priest's grandson to resume fasting and mourning because of the unfaithfulness of the returned exiles. This is the way in our lives too sometimes. Even after we realize our mistake and determine to correct it, the guilt and the shame of the mistake still need to be atoned for. And this is why it's so important for us, again, to be praying, praying without ceasing. And always praying, because what we're trying to do is come back again into relationship with God for anything that we have done wrong, that we need forgiveness for, that we are repenting for and asking God for repentance of. And this is why, again, I still believe this is why God has led me into the building today, because when we really begin to look at this, we truly think about our vision statement at First Mount Zion. Exalting Christ to restore, renew, and rebuild people. Exalting Christ to restore, renew, and rebuild people. But if we're doing that, that means that some level of reconstruction must have happened or should be happening in our lives daily on a continual basis. Because we know what Christ has done for us. We know the rebuilding that he's done in our lives. We know the reconstruction that has taken place within our very spirit. And if we believe that God can change wretches like us, that he can change wretches that are outside of the walls of the building, and they can become part of the gathering called the church, not the building. And I believe that with that, there is a push for us to continue to pray repentance to God every day. Because once we start believing that we got it and got it all and we don't need to ask for forgiveness, that's when we're already messing up. We're allowing the enemy to come in because we think we have the power on our own to do it. And we don't. It's only through the power of God. So let's be ushered by that and be motivated by it so that God will lead us to greener pastures. Don't ask the grass to become green if we have not allowed the nutrients of God to make it so. We must ask God for forgiveness. Ask God for the tools, what is needed to make us better, so that the kingdom of God becomes that much better. greater works you will do. That's what Christ said. And I honestly believe that because of the disciples that we will continue to make for the kingdom of God, because our lives are being improved and showing the face of God, the image of God, the characterization of God as we live according to his standards, and also asking him for the power in order to do so. Wow. Verses 7 and 8. Then a proclamation was made throughout Judah and Jerusalem that all the exiles should come to Jerusalem. Those who failed to come within 3 days would, if the leaders and elders so decided, forfeit all of their property and be expelled from the assembly of the exiles. So what you have here now is somewhat of, again, this proclamation. Each decision led to another with a broader scope. And Shechaniah's proposal to Ezra led to the oath taken by the leaders and those gathered locally. Now a proclamation was sent requiring all of the returned exiles in Judah to come to Jerusalem. A timeline of three days was given, as those furthest away from Jerusalem would be no more than 50 miles away, or 3 days' journey. Failure to come would lead to expulsion and confiscation of property, essentially a stripping away of legal rights. Ezra was granted this authority by King Artaxerxes. Ezra knows giving up a wife and her children is a major decision, and some would hesitate to do it. He is insistent on faithfully keeping God's law, though. If these men do not agree to keep the entire law, they will not be permitted to remain under that law. They will be excluded from a community by being separated from the congregation and from the inheritance by forfeiting their property, especially their land. And so with that, think about this. There's a stripping that's going on. They realize that physically based on if they don't reconcile, okay? And this is something I think for the church we have to understand more and more, that we cannot continue in those things that are ungodly and think that we're going to maintain our blessing. We cannot continue in those things that are ungodly and think that we will maintain our blessing. Keep that in mind. Because when we're forever being guided by God and listening to God, every step is ordered by God through Jesus Christ. And that's the chin check. That's the checks and balances, if you will, to keep us in due bounds with God and to continue walking in his path and in his way. Okay? Lastly, last verses, we'll get here. Verses 9 through 12. It says, within 3 days, all the people of Judah and Benjamin had gathered in Jerusalem. This took place on December 19th, and all the people were sitting in the square before the temple of God, and they were trembling both because of the seriousness of the matter and because it was raining. Then Ezra the priest stood and said to them, you have committed a terrible sin by marrying pagan women, and you have increased Israel's guilt. So now confess your sin to the Lord, the God of your ancestors, and do what he demands. Separate yourselves from the people of the land and from these pagan women. Then the whole assembly raised their voices and answered, yes, you are right. We must do as you say. And I'm going to read this last part, and I'm going to kind of go through some closing aspects on today. Commentator Wright says this, as commanded, the people gathered 3 days despite the cold December weather. Ezra records the day as the ninth month on the 20th day of the month. This is Kislev 20 on the Jewish calendar, which begins in the spring, placing their ninth month in the winter rather than the fall. Because the Jewish calendar is lunar, dates sometimes vary from year to year compared to the common Western solar calendar. However, since we can pin Ezra's account to a specific year in King Cyrus' reign, scholars can calculate the date of this particular Kislev 20 as December 19th on our Gregorian calendar. The combination of the fear of God's wrath and being drenched and cold caused them to tremble. Under these circumstances, Ezra boldly confronted their unfaithfulness and called for their confession and action. The whole assembly agreed, since it was rainy season, November through March, and the assembly was very large. It would take 3 months for all marriages to be investigated. In the end, 113 men, including several priests and Levites, were found guilty of ungodly marriages. Now, the whole premise here is the sin, okay? The sin itself. They had to come into recognition of the sin that they had committed. Now, with that came the aspect of a confession of faith, a confession of those sins, and a recognition that they needed to confess of those sins before they could move forward out of the exile. Now, I would say this is not just, again, the exile of coming out of Babylon back into Jerusalem. It's also a spiritual exile, an exile that basically, I'm going to basically say is that they lost relationship with God and begin to do ungodly things, but now need to be restored in right relationship with God. So this is where the spiritual connotation of the restoration and reconciliation actually comes in. And you can't be rebuilt, you can't be restored, you can't be reactivated, you can't be reenacted until you come to the place of reckoning with yourself and your sin. And as a church, that means that the body of faith needs to look at themselves individually and be in relationship with God, open and honest with all genuineness and authenticity, to come to the place of reckoning with God with regards to your stuff that you know is not of God, and it's unholy and it's definitely sacrilegious, or more so unsacred. That's why it's so important to be able to do that. The beauty of the church is that the church is filled with imperfection. What I mean by that is that none of us are perfect. None of us are, including the preacher. None of us are perfect. But as long as we are reconciling back to God, God will hear us, reconcile us, and bring us to the place of repentance, because we're repenting of our sins openly and genuinely to Him, not to anyone else, but to Him. A scripture that has often been said in our church, and one of the favorite scriptures of mine, as well as the late Deacon William Hughes Singer. He would read it often in Bible study. It's when God answered Solomon, and God told him in 2 Chronicles 7 and 14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, that I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. All God wants is obedience. All God wants is for us to be honest with ourselves and honest with Him, because He already knows. And when we do that, we will become a church that some people won't even recognize, because of the simple fact that we're trying to do it the best way we can via God's way. I know it sounds simple, and I know it sounds ultrally simplistic, but that's the reality of the church. First Mount Zion members, I want to just say this to you. It's one, another reason why I believe God led me into the church and put some pictures up on Facebook. We must make sure that we're giving to our church with resources. GiveLify is open. Go on your cell phone. It's right there. It's an app. Go right to it, and you can give via GiveLify. Come by the church at any time. If no one's here, just drop your offering in the drop box. If someone's here, just make sure you just give it, and we'll make sure to allocate it. Either way, it's fine. Mail your contributions to the church. We have a mailbox, 1515 Remount Road, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28208. It'll come right here, and we'll allocate it thusly. Also, by PayPal on our website, hit that donate button, takes you right to PayPal, give away your debit card, credit card, that way. Every Saturday from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. here at the church, 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. in the fellowship hall, someone is there from our finance committee in order to take your tithes and offerings. Just come out of church and give it. You have a multitude of ways. And you, and not only a multitude of ways, but you're without excuse with regards to giving to your church. Why did I put the pictures up? I want you to see what's going on with the dollars that you're giving to First Mount Zion. It's not just to pay the pastor. And to be honest with you, again, the church, you know the sacrifice that I've made over the past several months of my own salary here at the church to ensure that the church proceeds forward and goes forward. I made a sacrifice. My question as a member, you being a member of First Mount Zion, will you make a sacrifice? For those that are watching, wherever you're watching from, you might be in Washington, D.C., you may be in Seattle, Washington, you may be overseas somewhere in Thailand, you may be in Australia, Japan, you may be in Russia, I don't know. You may be in India, in Africa, one of the various countries there on the mother continent. You may be in Europe, in England, or France, or Portugal, or Spain, somewhere in Belarus, or somewhere, you may be anywhere in the world and watching us. If you feel led to give to our ministry, please do so. And we thank you. We thank you for hearing God's voice and giving to our ministry. There are various ways that you can give. But we just ask that you do give. If God leads you, God leads you to that, just give. If God leads you, let the Spirit lead you towards that. But with regards to even our own membership at First Mount Zion, we must continue to give. These things, God is blessing us immensely during this pandemic. There are dollars that we have not touched from savings, from our savings accounts during the pandemic, and it's allowing those numbers to grow. There's things going on in your church, and we need to make sure that the house is taken care of. So with that being said, please make sure that you're giving. Matter of fact, get your phone out now. Just get it out. Get it out now. If you can give GiveLify or PayPal, just get your phone out and begin the process. Very simple. Give to your church. Again, it's about doing the work of Jesus Christ, the ministry of the kingdom of God. That's what we're about. And so with regards to that, make sure that we're doing what's necessary so that the kingdom of God is enhanced, that souls are saved, and that the ministry, the preaching of Jesus Christ continues to go forward throughout the world, not just First Mount Zion and not just Charlotte. So a lot that we're doing. I wanted to come into the house. It's been a while just sitting up here, and I wanted to make sure that I came on today. God's blessings to you. Again, announcements will come out for the week once I can get the all call back up on my phone, and we'll make sure that the information gets out. I would lead people to the website, but to our Facebook page for announcements, because I've got them up on there. And so you can actually scroll down and find them and all the things that are going on. Again, continue to be in prayer for Minister Robbie Clark's family in the passing of her brother, Reverend Willie Simpson. And again, his funeral services will be at Greer Funeral Home on John McCarroll Avenue on this Friday. I don't want to give you dates and times because I don't have them in my mind, but they're on, again, our page. So you can pull those things up and be able to see them. First Mount Zion family, God bless you. We had an awesome time last week. I want to thank everyone for who participated, our praise team, for our park and praise. We're trying to make sure that we're at least on the campus once a month as, you know, folks are getting their vaccines and things of that nature, and things are starting to, you know, slowly open up that we can get back into that space. I encourage everyone. I know folks have mixed emotions and feelings about the vaccine. Get your vaccine. I'm going to just tell you up front, go get it. I get my second shot this week. Get the vaccine. It's saving lives. Would you rather have COVID with no protection of a vaccine, and then end up with being on a ventilator and possibly passing away, or getting the vaccine? If you did get COVID, you know that vaccine is going to protect you from going to the hospital and being hospitalized because of the virus. To me, it's that simple. That's just me. Everyone's going to do what they want to do, but I'm encouraging everyone, please, ma'am and sir, please get a vaccine for COVID-19. Please get it. With that being said, again, announcements are out there and out. All calls will be going out this week. Please be in prayer for your pastor. I'm starting to end this first year of my DMN program. I have a paper due tomorrow that I've got mostly done. I got to finish it. As long as I get it in by 11:59 tomorrow, I'm okay. So that'll be the deal. And hopefully I'll get that done. If I don't finish it today, I definitely have to have it done tomorrow and to get that submitted so I can be done with a second class. So I can work on a third paper, which is due in about 2.5 weeks. So keep praying for your pastor as I go through this doctoral process. So God's blessings to you. I know many people commented. I really didn't want to get into a lot of the comments per se on today because I knew there were going to be a lot of them. But I thank God for all of you. Oh, wow. Amen. Thank you, Sister Peek. I'm reading some of all of you making comments and so forth. I just thank God for you. Thanking God for all that he continues to do. First Mount Zion, continue to hold on to the faith of God through Jesus Christ. We're going to make it. We're going to make it. And we're going to get through this. And I can't wait to see everybody when we eventually enter back into this place. But don't come in this place with the old... with old wineskins. We're already in the process of making new wine spiritually. Bring your new wineskin when we come back into this place, because it's truly going to be a Holy Ghost time when we do. The Spirit of God has to be right. And in order for that to happen, we got to allow the Spirit to work and motivate us to that place of being right, not in our own sight, but being right with God and his righteousness. So much so in this lesson, there's so much that was in this lesson that applies for all of us. Thank God for all of you. Amen. God's blessings to you. I am going to give a formal benediction at this time. Amen. Enjoy your day. It's a beautiful day outside here in Charlotte. Amen. The pastor's going to be doing something today. I'm not going to tell you what that is. Some may already know, but I got an itch to, and you already know what it is. So I'm seriously considering it. In fact, I'm probably going to end up doing that on today because it's that season of trying to catch fish. Amen. God's blessings to you. We thank God for you, First Mount Zion family. Now, as I look to be dismissed, please pray with me at this time. Father God, we thank you and praise you, Lord, for the experience that we're having even now. Lord, this is your house. This place that I'm sitting in is your house. But also where we sit in our living rooms and our kitchens and wherever we are, oh God, our very being and image, oh God, of you is also your house. That's where the church is. We ask, Father, that you continue to work through us, guide us, move us in every way, shape, fashion, and form. And Lord, we'll be careful to give your name praise, honor, and glory. We ask, Lord, that you lead us and guide us on the furtherance of the day, and allow us, God, to continue to see your glory be made manifest in every aspect of our lives, from our jobs to our families, our children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, Lord, and places where we play basketball, play golf, play tennis, oh Lord, go to ponds and go and fish, whatever we're doing in life, oh God, that our lives are magnified. Then, Lord, our lives magnify and exalt your name, that they bring honor and glory to you. Bless us in every way, Lord, and we'll be careful to give your name honor and glory. Forgive us for our transgressions and sins, Lord, for we are not perfect, but we serve a God who is. Thank you, Lord, for the salvation power that rests in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of Man and the Son of God, in whose name I pray. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us henceforth, now and forevermore. The people of God said amen, amen, and amen. I am Pastor Hagwood, pastor of First Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church in Charlotte, North Carolina, where we are exalting Christ to restore, renew, and rebuild people to serve the kingdom of God. God's blessings to you. Love you in the Lord. I love you in the Lord. I love you in the Lord. And there is nothing that you can do about it, because God is love. Thank God for you on today, First Mount Zion family, and everyone that's joined us on today. We love you. We love you. We love you. Take care and be blessed and have an awesome day. And so willing, God willing, you have a blessed week on this week. God blesses to you. Take care and be blessed.